Today, in today's session, I'll be presenting on non-orthogonal multiple axis techniques. So the overview of my presentation is, so first we will be seeing the introduction to the various multiple axis scheme and multiplexing techniques, after which we will be seeing what is orthogonal multiple axis, and then we will be performing a comparison between the orthogonal multiple axis and non-orthogonal multiple axis, and then we are going to see about the NOMA system model and what are the key technologies that are involved in NOMA, that is superposition coding and successive interference cancellation. Both these techniques will be explained in detail, and then we will be seeing a two-user power domain downlink NOMA scenario. So after which we are going to see the performance analysis of NOMA in terms of signal to noise ratio, capacity, and bit error rate. So moving on to the introduction, so what is difference between multiple axis and multiplexing? Because the title itself has non-orthogonal multiple axis. So before we get into the details of NOMA, we'll just have an introduction of what is multiple axis. So what is the difference between multiplexing and multiple axis? So in what exactly is multiplexing? So multiplexing is the process of combining multiple signals and then transmitting them over a common channel or media. So generally, multiplexing combines several low-speed signals for transmission over a high-speed connection. So now if we have more than one source of signal, and we want to transmit them together, then we can implement multiplexing. A device that performs this multiplexing operation is called the multiplexer, shortly called as the MUX, and the device that performs the reverse process is called the demultiplexer, shortly called as DMUX. So a communication system without demuxing, so how will it be? So without without multiplexing, so a common system will carry one signal at a moment, right? So that's when we have three communication channels in this case, because we have three signal sources. So without multiplexing, we will need three communication channels to carry these three signals. So in this case, a large bandwidth is wasted. Right, so in the multiplexing, it carries these three signals simultaneously. So it uses only one common channel to carry all these three signals. So therefore, in this way, when we implement multiplexing, bandwidth is effectively used. So basically, multiplexing works on the physical layer, and in multiplexing, we don't provide a dedicated resource to a single source. That is, we don't dedicate a complete time frame to a single source. Okay. So moving on to multiple axis, as the name suggests, we can get to know that multiple axis means multiple users accessing the channel or a link. So multiple axis can be defined as a technique that permits multiple users to simultaneously access a given frequency slot. So multiple axis provides dedicated resources to the user with a time or frequency constraint in comparison to multiplexing, which doesn't provide any resources. And here we don't require any additional hardware to combine and separate the desired signal from other users, like how we used MUX and DMUX in multiplexing. So here we have, instead we have a channel access scheme based on a multiple access protocol and control mechanism. So we call it shortly as the media access protocol, that is the MAC protocol. So we know that, as I told earlier, like multiplexing acts in the physical layer, whereas your multiple access works in the data link layer. So next, moving on to the types of multiplexing, we have the multiplexing being classified into analog and digital multiplexing. So in analog multiplexing, Frequency division multiplexing is commonly used, and in digital multiplexing we have time division multiplexing, which is the most popularly used technique. So going in deep to frequency division multiplexing, we use this technique extensively in television and radio transmission. And in this technique, the bandwidth of the communication channel, okay, should be greater than that of the combined bandwidth of the individual signal. Okay, so the FDM divides the bandwidth of a frequency division multiplexing divides the bandwidth of a channel into several logical subchannels, and each subchannel is allocated for a different signal frequency. So each subchannel is also separated by an unused bandwidth, so that we call that as guard band to prevent the overlapping. Okay, so how this FDM works is, so at the transmitter end, we have multiple transmitters, that is in this case we have like three signals, and in the receiver end also we have multiple receivers. So the communication channel is present in between the transmitter and the receiver. So at the transmitter end, each transmitter sends a signal of different frequency. So here the transmitter 1 sends a signal of 30 kilohertz, and signal 2, transmitter 2 is transmitting a signal of 40 kilohertz, and transmitter 3 is transmitting a signal of 50 kilohertz. Okay, so these signals are multiplexed or combined by using the mux, and then transmitted to the multiplex and transmitted to the channel. And at the receiver end, this multiplex signals are separated by using DMUX. Okay, and then the signal is sent respectively to the corresponding receivers. Okay, so the advantage of using this multiple frequency division multiplexing is that you can transmit multiple signals simultaneously. As you can see from the figure, you can see that you are able to transmit many signals simultaneously, and you don't need any synchronization between the transmitter and the receiver. The only disadvantage that we can see in FDM is it requires large bandwidth communication channels. So in our case, we have taken a three-user scenario, but when you consider like when there are going to be many users, so you need many channels that has to be allocated for the individual users. So in that case, your bandwidth requirement will be very large for frequency division multiplexing. Whereas in time division multiplexing, so this is a technique where multiple signals are combined and transmitted one after the other. Okay, you can see somewhere they are transmitted one after the other on the same communication channel. And at the receiver side, the signals are separated and they are received. Each signal is received by the user at different time slots. So in frequency division multiplexing, we saw that all signals of different frequency are transmitted simultaneously. But here in TDM, each user is allocated a particular time slot or time interval during which the data is being transmitted. In TDM, all the signals are not transmitted simultaneously, as you can see in frequency division multiplexing. Instead, they are transmitted one after the other. So in figure, we can see that we send signal A, then we are sending signal B, and then we are sending signal C, and then we are sending signal D. So thus, each user occupies an entire bandwidth for a short period of time. So the advantages of time division multiplexing here is like full bandwidth is utilized by the particular user for a particular interval of time. Okay. So user A is able to have a hold of the channel for a particular time completely. So in time division multiplexing, the only problem, the problem of crosstalk is also very less in comparison with the frequency division multiplexing. And the disadvantage of time division multiplexing is that your perfect synchronization is required between the transmitter and receiver in order to get the data in the flow. Okay. So next we'll see about the multiple access type. So there are several ways to allow access to the channel. So we have TDMA, FDMA, CDMA, which are time division multiple access, frequency division multiple access, and code division multiple access. So let me first consider frequency division multiple access. So in frequency division multiple access is incorporated by dividing the available frequency among the users, so that each of your user transmits and receives on a frequency different from that of the other user. So you can see from the picture, like your frequency access is being partitioned, and each frequency slot is allocated to each user. So this is a fairly simple technology, and it works well on analog communication links. So each frequency band here is separated by a guard band. So there is some separation between the transmissions in the event of slight variations of frequencies. So when we consider a wireless environment like a cell phone, there may be hundreds and thousands of communications occurring, right? So, and there are not enough frequency to divide among all the devices. So to get around this problem, what we can do is the size of the cell can be reduced, and the power of the transmission can also be reduced, and the frequency can be reused in different non-adjacent cells. Okay, and also this technique makes more communications possible. It also introduces the problem of how to handle a active communication when one user is going to move from one cell to another cell. So in real time, we'll be moving from one place to another. So a handoff has to take place. So in this case, the sender must change to a different frequency that is used in the adjacent cell. So this process of moving from cell to cell is called as handoff, and the technique to provide this uninterrupted conversation across the cell boundaries are a little complicated, right? So frequency division multiple access technique can be used in applications where you need to accommodate a large number of users, and the bandwidth is not a main consideration. But whereas in time division multiple access, all the users use the same frequency. However, each user is given a time slot, and he has to transmit in that order. So that is, like, if user one is transmitting, then user two has to transmit, and then user three has to transmit, and so on. So this is also termed as this round robin approach. So the time allocated for each device can be fixed, or it can be variable in length, and at any instant, user can use only one time slot to send his data, and then the user must wait until his turn comes around again. Okay, so time division multiple access has some advantages over frequency division multiple access, which makes the time division multiple access more feasible for networking. So with time division multiple access, users can dynamically be assigned multiple time slots when other users are idle and do not need the time slot. So by using this method, we can increase the throughput of the users. And on the other hand, the TDMA users must be properly time synchronized. Okay. So next we will look into code division multiple access. So another approach to the multiple access problem is to combine your time domain and frequency domain technologies, and in this CDMA scheme, the users are using both time slot and the frequency technology. So the time slot is the amount of time used on a specific frequency, and the frequency element is the usage of different frequencies. So in this technique, a code word is assigned to represent a binary. and each user uses a different code word. For example, if one user is going to represent binary 1 with 00, the other user is going to represent the same binary 1 as 10 to indicate binary digit 1. So each of these codes is transmitted for the same time duration and across different frequencies, because each of the recipients uses a different code word dictionary. So the recipient's message must be extracted from all the bits spread across the different frequencies. So the code words used in the scheme must be carefully selected so that there is no confusion that is going to exist among the different users. So we can have a set of compatible code words that can be used together, and the code words must be orthogonal in nature. So you may wonder, like, why hopping between the frequencies and using more bits in a code word to represent a single bit would be advantageous. So the answer is that in protecting the data from being picked up and understood by an unauthorized party. So if a recipient does not know the different frequency and code word that is used, the information cannot be properly deciphered. Okay. So it is mandatory that the code word that is being used in the transmitter should also be available with the receiver in order to decipher it properly. So the first use of all these spread spectrum technologies was primarily made in military, and now it is used on civilian wireless communication channels for same protection purposes. On the other hand, there are some issues with CDMA. So the first issue is the level of complexity that is needed to implement the features. So second is the proper power management is required, because even though you are using orthogonal codes, if the power of one code is very high than the other code, obviously it can go and cause interference. Or it can be captured by the other user. So proper power management should also be maintained. And lastly, a large band of contiguous frequencies is also needed. So with this, we have finished a small introduction to multiplexing and multiple access tech type. So moving inside, like, what is the comparison of orthogonal multiple access and non-orthogonal multiple access? Okay, so in when we consider the cellular mobile communication, we divide the whole network into cells, right? And each cell is covered by a base station or a tower, okay, that is trying to serve multiple users. And we know that as we get closer to the tower, your data rate, your data rate gets better. And as we move away from your tower, the performance will decrease gradually. This is also due to being close to other cells. We have interference from that cell also. And this is going to decrease your signal to noise ratio and end up having problem in your data rate and bit rate. Okay, so in orthogonal multiple access, we have resources being orthogonal to each other, like orthogonal communication resources are used in order to avoid this multiple access interference. And when we take get into the history of the mobile communication, we know that 1G, 2G and 3G, they provided voice services, and later 3.5G and 4G LTE, they provided data services. So later 4G data rate is going up to 1 Gbps, but still there is a drastic increase in the number of mobile users. And we also know that the number of wireless devices also are increasing every day. So the upcoming 5G systems are expected to exceed the 4G requirements in terms of the capacity, data rate, throughput and spectral efficiency. We are in need to accommodate more number of users. So going back to the previous technologies, we know that 2G had FDM and TDM as accessing technology, and 3G has this code division multiple access. where we assign codes to users, and these codes must be orthogonal to each other. So again, there, when you're going to increase the number of, when the number of users are increasing, you're going to increase the number of codes. So this will again result in interference. And in 4G, it is a kind of 2G with overlapping OFDM. So here we split the resources which are patterned in time and frequency into small slots, and you assign the slots to each user based on their requirements. So in general, all these three or four generations, users are allocated orthogonal resources. And you can see from the figure, you can see like in orthogonal multiplexes, you have the users being allocated with orthogonal resources. That is either separate time or separate frequency allocation is given to avoid interference between them. Because this inter-user interference will decrease the performance in terms of the spectral rate or data rate and signal to noise ratio. So what can be done to elevate this, get rid of this problem? So once a possible solution is to break this orthogonality. Why we are going to break this orthogonality is because we know that, as I said earlier, like there is an increasing demand in the mobile users and we have limited resources. And if you're going to follow orthogonal multiple axes and you're going to allocate dedicated resources to each and every user, we cannot meet the standards of the 5G requirement. So taking a motivation from the disadvantages of the orthogonal multiple access scheme, so your non-orthogonal multiple access comes into picture. So here, non-orthogonal multiple access is providing high spectral efficiency. So how do I say that non-orthogonal multiplexes is providing better spectral efficiency than orthogonal multiplexes? In orthogonal multiplexes, a specific frequency resource is assigned to each user, even if it is having a good or bad channel condition. Thus, the overall system will suffer from lower spectral efficiency. Whereas in your non-orthogonal multiplexes, the same frequency is assigned to, you can see like the same frequency is assigned to multiple mobile users with both good and bad condition at the same time. So hence the resource assigned for the weak user is also used by the strong user. So therefore the probability of having high throughput and spectral efficiency is found in non-orthogonal multiplexes. And in orthogonal multiplexes, the users with very good channel conditions have the highest higher priority to be served first, while the user with a bad condition, they have to wait for the access, which leads to a fairness problem. Okay, so and high latency because you have to wait for it, right? So this approach and also your orthogonal multiplexes cannot support massive connectivity. So however, non-orthogonal multiplexes can serve multiple users with different channel conditions simultaneously. Therefore, the non-orthogonal multiple access is providing massive connectivity. Also, user fairness is satisfied and there is low latency. So, low latency also. So with this, we can see that, we can understand that in non-orthogonal multiple access, like all users share the same time, frequency and spatial domain, and their signals do overlap. And because of this overlapping, you have interference, and we'll see how this interference is being tackled by NOMA. Because in orthogonal multiple access, this interference problem will not be prevailing. But whereas now we are going to allocate many users to the same frequency and time band, interference will be present here. So we'll see how this can be mitigated in NOMA. So with all this, I think you would have got an idea like why NOMA is an ideal multiple access solution for 5G. To brief upon, due to the increasing demand, for the spectrum and the increasing wireless devices day by day. And since we also have limited resources, we are in need of massive connectivity. So we have to bring a promising solution to meet all these demands of 5G. So in order to meet this demand of 5G, non-orthogonal multiple access is introduced. So getting into NOMA, so we have two types of NOMA. One is power domain NOMA and the other one is core domain NOMA. So in power domain NOMA, we are going to assign unique power levels to each user. So each user will be allocated unique different powers, and multiple users can transmit their signals sharing the same time frequency resources, and each using it by using its allocated power. Next is core domain NOMA. So here this majorly relies on code books, scrambling sequences to non-orthogonally allocate the resources to users. But in our session, we are going to primarily, we are going to mainly focus on this power domain downlink NOMA. Okay. So here, as I said already, we are going to assign unique power levels to the user. And how do we decide the level of power that is going to be allocated to the user depends upon the channel characteristics of the user. So you can see the system model for a two-user power domain downlink NOMA here. So let me explain the figure to you. So here we are going to consider downlink transmission from base station to the users. So the difference between downlink and uplink is that downlink, here we have the transmission from the base station to the mobile users, whereas for uplink, it will be from the mobile user to the base station. So we will be considering a downlink scenario. So we have the base station transmitting simultaneously to two users by using the same frequency, okay, by applying NOMA concept over here. So users are selected such that there is no possible distance between them. So this is your user one, which is going to be termed as the far user, which is away from your base station. And then you have your near user, which is close to your base station. So generally, your near user has strong channel characteristics and your far user has weak channel gain. So here in NOMA, we are going to serve both of them at the same frequency and time. So now the base station is going to allocate low power to the near user and high power to the far user. So why we are transmitted power is split in such a way is because some you can see, like for the far user, the distance between the base station and your far user is more, and for your near user it is less. And here also your signal has to transmit to long distance, so for that we are giving more power to the far user. So here the distance is less when compared to the far user, so we are going to allocate less power when compared to the far user. So so it's obvious here that there will be interference between these two users, because we are going to send data of both user 1 and user 2 at same frequency at same time. So you can see them both overlapping each other. So obviously there is going to be an interference, because your user 1 would have received both the user 1's data and user 2's data. So user 2 would have also received your user 1 data and user 2 data. Okay. So we'll see like how this both the user 1 data and user 2 data are combined and sent to the channel to the user 1 and user 2. And also we will see like how the user 1 and user 2 are going to decode their information alone from the composite signal. Okay. So in order to explain that, we have two key operations that are being involved in NOMA. So one is superposition coding and the other is successive inference cancellation. called as SIC. So let me first explain you what is superposition coding. And the superposition coding is done at the transmitter end. So let us say that we have two users, user 1 and user 2. So we are considering a two user scenario, right? So we have user 1 and user 2, which are going to communicate simultaneously using the same frequency. So let your x1 denote your user 1's data and x2 denote your user 2's data. So for simplicity purpose, we are going to assume that each user has only 4 bits of data to send. I know that this assumption is far from reality, but in order to understand the basic working of NOMA, I'm considering only 4 bits. So you can see the graphical view of x1 and x2 here in this graph. Like you have your user 1 data to be 1010, right? So you can see it is mapped accordingly in the graph, like 1010. Okay, so this is data of user 1, and then you have your data, user 2 data, that is 0110. So again, when you map it here, you have 0110. Okay, so any data has to undergo this modulation before being transmitted. So now we are going to modulate both x1 and x2 before transmission, and we are going to use BPSK modulation, that is binary phase shift keying modulation over here. So in binary phase shift keying modulation, we know that the zeros will be mapped to minus 1 and 1 will be mapped to plus 1. So now comparing your previous data, you know that x1 is 1010. So I told, like, in BPSK modulation, we will be mapping all your zeros to minus 1 and your 1 to plus 1. So x1 is mapped, after mapping, it will be plus 1, minus 1, and plus 1, minus 1, respectively. And similarly, we, for x2 data, your 0110 will be mapped to minus 1, plus 1, plus 1, and minus 1. So the graphical representation is given here. So you can see that this particular data is being mapped here, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, and minus 1. So again, here you have user 2's data, that is modulated data, that is minus 1, plus 1, plus 1, and minus 1. Okay, so NOMA requires the superposition coding at the transmitter side. So superposition coding is just a fancy term for this power domain multiplexing. So what is the basic meaning of superpose? Is to add, right? So we are basically going to add both your x1, user 1's data, and x2, your user 2's data together. But before doing that, we are going to multiply them with different power levels, and then we will add them together. Okay, so this is one important concept that you have to know in non-orthogonal multiplexes. So from the previous figure, you know that both your x1 and x2, they have a peak amplitude of plus 1 to minus 1. So that means they have unit power, right? So we know that power is equal to amplitude squared, right? So let us say we give power wave A1 to be 0.5 to user 1, and we are going to allocate a A2 is equal to 0.25 to user 2. The rule to follow here is that your A1 and A2 should be summed up in such a way that it results in 1. You can experiment with changing these values, like 0.75 to 0 and 0.25, but only condition is that for the far user, you have to give more power. And for your near user, you have to give less power in comparison with your far user. So that is the concept here. And next, we are going to scale your input data with your power coefficient. Okay, so here we are using a fixed power allocation. So first, we are going to scale this x1 and x2 with a1 root of a1 and a2 respectively. So why we have used the square root here is because A1 and A2 represent the power scaling factors. So to make them represent amplitude, we take the square root. So the amplitude of x1 when you scale it to a root of a1, so your root of 0.75 will be 0.866, and your amplitude of x2 is scaled to root a2, which is root of 0.25 will be 0.5. So now, in order to obtain the amplitude scaled version of the data, what you have to do is you have to multiply your root a1 with your user 1 data. So user 1 data means your you have your BPSK modulated data, right? So +1 -1 +1 -1. So you have to multiply your user 1 data along with your power weight that you have calculated for your user 1, and x2 is multiplied with root of a2. Okay, so you get 0.866 -0.866, 0.866, and 0.8 -0.866 for the first data. So, and you can see this being represented here graphically. And then for root a2 into x2, when you multiply your x2 with root a2, you will have this output. So again, we are going to represent it graphically over here. Okay. So what is, as I told previously, superposition coding is nothing but adding two signals together. So here, now it's going, it's time to add both the scaled versions of the signal together. So that is your x is equal to your scaled version of the user 1 data plus your scaled version of your user 2 data. And this is called, this resulting signal, you're going to call it as the superposition coded signal. Okay, and on adding both the values, you arrive at x is equal to 0.366 -0.366 and 1.366 -1.366. Okay, so this is your final superposition coded signal. Okay, that is of this form. Okay, so what is superposition coding is basically in non-orthogonal multiplexes, we are implementing the superposition coding in the transmitter side. So where we are going to consider two user 1 and user 2 data, and we are going to scale it with the power weight, and then we are going to add them together, and this composite signal, that is your superposition coded signal, is being sent to the transmitted into the channel. So that's how superposition coding is done. So you have to make a note of another point here is your x is a linear combination of both your x1 and x2. So next we'll see like how we can recover. So now that in your transmitter side, your superposition coding part is over. So now you have your signal that has to be transmitted is ready. So now this is being transmitted into the actual channel. So next we'll see on the receiver side how the receiver is going to do the decoding process. So for that we are going to make use of successive interference calculation. Okay, so the key technique that is used in the receiver side to decode the user 1 and user 2 data is SIC. So when we let me give a quick recap like of superposition coding. We had two users with data 1 and data 2 respectively, and we first did the BPSK modulation to both x1 and x2, and then we obtained the superposition coded signal as x is equal to root a1 x1 plus root a2 x2, where a1 and a2 are the power weights given to x1 and x2 respectively. So we took an example of x1 as 1010 and x2 to be 0110, right? So before decoding the information, let us first look at the SIC algorithm. So the SIC algorithm consists of three steps. So this SIC process is an iterative algorithm. What when I mean iterative algorithm, it is like a repetitive process. So where your data is decoded in the order of decreasing power levels. What do I mean by decreasing power levels? So I told earlier, like in Noma, we are going to allocate more power to the far user and less power to the near user. Okay. So in that case, the user with high power level will be decoded first, and then the user with the next highest power level will be decoded, and this process is continued until we decode all users' data. So for our case, we have a simple case of two user Noma system. So we'll just see what are the steps that are involved in this successive interference cancellation. So first, we are going to directly decode the X to get the signal that is weighed with high power. So for example, in our case, X1 is given more weight, right? Because it is a far user, we are given more weight. So in that case, the direct decoding of X will give your X1. Next thing, step 2, we are going to multiply the signal decoded in first step. So in the first step, we have decoded X1, right, directly. So that signal, we are going to multiply it with its corresponding weight, that is root A1. And then we are going to subtract it from your composite signal, that is X. Okay. So after that, we are going to decode the signal that is obtained in the first step to get the other signal, which was multiplexed with your low power, that is your near user signal. Okay, so I understand that this steps are pretty foggy. So let me give a detailed explanation about those steps. So first, in our example, we have kept the power weight as A1 is 0.75, right? And your A2, that is your weight for your near user, is 0.25, right? So I told, like, we are giving more, which means that we are given X1 more power than X2. So by following the first step, we are going to decode the signal which is given the higher power. So in that case, we are going to do direct decoding of X so that we get X1. So what do we mean by direct decoding? So in our case, we have used BPSK modulation at the transmitter side, right? So what do we mean by direct decoding is that we are going to apply this BPSK demodulation directly to the received X, okay? So we might think that we would run into problem because, we, as I told in the previous slide, X is a linear combination of both X1 and X2, right? Which means there are two different messages in your X1. Sorry, in your X, you have two different messages. So, but we will see shortly, like, how this SIC will handle this problem nicely. So let's go ahead and perform BPSK demodulation on X by following the first step. So this is your superposition coded signal. So this signal will be received at your far user, right? So your far users will have something of this form. So now, what we are going to do is, we are going to do BPSK demodulation over here. So what is BPSK demodulation? So BPSK demodulation is basically simple thresholding. So let's see that we are going to set the threshold to zero. So for each symbol, if the amplitude is going to exceed zero, we are going to detect the symbol as one. And if it is going to go below zero, we are going to detect it as zero. Okay, so this is BPSK demodulation. So this is the plot of X, right? And the threshold is this denoted by this black horizontal line. So let's decode X symbol by symbol. Okay, so we observe that the first symbol is lying about the threshold of zero. So we take the decision that the first and the third symbol transmitted bits are one, and the second and fourth symbol lie below the threshold, right? So we take a decision that the second and fourth transmitted bits are zero. So in that form, your decoded bit is 1 0 1 0, right? So your decoded sequence is 1 0 1 0. which is nothing but your user one data. Okay, so your user one data. So at the receiver side, we are going to apply successive interference cancellation directly to the user, our user. So the user which is allocated the higher power will be decoded first. So, and we are going to apply the BPSK demodulation directly to that user, and we have decoded the sequence as per the step one. Okay. So in other words, we can say like we arrived at X1 by directly performing BPSK demodulation on X, and while doing this, we totally ignore the fact that X has a component of X2 too. But the presence of X2 will not be very predominant in your path user because we have given higher power to the path user. So by the time your signal is going to reach a path user, the near user's data would have been faded away because since we have given only less power to user the near user, right? So in other words, we can see even if a little data from the X2 is present, we can treat it as interference and we can ignore it. So the first step of SIC process is complete, and next we can see that the values of your root A1 and root A2 are known to us because they are design choices. Further, we obtained X1 by following V or step 1. Okay. So if we subtract this A1 X1, root of A1 X1 from your X, we will be left with what? Root A2 X2, right? From root of A2 X2, it is pretty much easy to obtain your X2. So let's move on to step 2. Okay, so in step 2, we have to multiply the X1 component. So using your step 1, you would have got your X1 data by directly applying BPSK demodulation. So now in the next step, what you have to do is you have to multiply your X1 with its corresponding power weight, and then you have to subtract it from the whole signal. In that case, in your step 2, you will be only having your second user's data, that is root A2 into X2, right? So in third step, what we will be doing is you have your root A2 into X2 now. So here we are going to apply again direct decoding over here to decode the sequence. Okay. So if after subtracting your root of A1 X1 from your composite signal, you will have your remaining signal like this in this form. So you can see that you have the graphical representation here. So again, for BPSK demodulation, as I told earlier, like if below threshold, if it is going to be, we are going to consider it as 0, and above threshold, we are going to consider the bit as 1. So again, with the remaining signal, when you apply your BPSK demodulation, you can see that you have 0, 1, 1, 0. So that is your demodulated data of your user 2. Okay. So this is about SIC. So in our case, we have taken a two user scenario, and it is not mandatory that only two users can be used. So when your number of users are going to be increased, we are going to perform the SIC algorithm until we have decoded the last user's data. Okay. So now we have considered a perfectly ideal case by not considering any channel noise or the effects. So in order to get a hold of the real-time scenario, we are going to see how the bit rate performance of NOMA is calculated in the performance of relay fading channel. So okay, I'll take a minute to ask if you have any queries in this superposition coding and SIC technique.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Madam, you told like highest power level user is detected first.
Yes, sir.
Is there any reason for that detecting the highest power level index going on like that?
Yes, sir. Sir, I told like the highest power is allocated to the power user, right, sir? So
yes,
in the
ma'am.
power user, when you're going to allocate the higher power, I also your in NOMA concept, I told like in your power user, you will be receiving both your near user and far user's data, right, sir? So when in at your far user, by the time the data reaches your far user, the near user they are giving low power. So in that case, your near user's data will mostly be fade away. You will only be having your X1 data because you are giving high power to your far user and you are transmitting. So to make your process easy, so if we start from the far user, where you have hold of your data one, right? So after you calculate your user one data from there, you can easily take your user one data from there and you can come and subtract it from your near user's data. So in near user, your far user's data will be very predominant. So in that case, if you would decode your user one's data first and if you keep it, it will be very easy for you to decode in your near user path. Otherwise, if you start with your near user, you will not have any knowledge about your far user data, right?
At what level?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. And another question, ma'am. You are given A1 0.75, A2 0.25.
Yes,
so if you want to means dynamically allocate the power,
yes,
based
sir,
on
you
the
can
user
dynamically
location.
Allocate, sir. It is not mandatory that you have to give 0.75 and 0.25. The only rule that you have to follow there is your A1 and A2 should sum up to 1. So and another thing is you have to give higher power, your power weight for your far user should be greater than your near user. So in that combination, you can allocate your power dynamically.
Madam, how to do that? Madam, is there any method for that?
So it is like trial and error method only. So since yet, we have to just try and see, like you have for two user scenario, like you can change the power allocation factors. Like here we are given 0.75 and 0.25. So you can
yes.
first try that, and after that you can change the weights that you have allocated, and you can observe like how your bitter rate is there, and then you can do this. Also, like since we are talking about this machine learning, you know, machine learning, so we can also develop algorithms like to find out like which value can be optimal. So that can also be done. So dynamic allocation you can do. It is on trial and error basis only. So you have to find the correct point. That.
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. Yes, sir. So since there's no queries from the audience again, so we can go to the next concept. Like as I told earlier, we only saw this working of NOMA in without any noise or other channel component. So now we will see the bitter rate performance of NOMA in presence of relay channel. Okay. So for this, I think you all are aware of this like concept, like where wireless channel is prone to many multipath propagation and fading, and several channel models are available to capture this effect of fading, but for our model now today we have taken the relay fading scenario. So now the first formula will tell you the superposition coded NOMA signal, that is x is equal to root p of root a1 x1 plus root a2 x2. So root p is nothing but your transmit power, the whole transmit power, and A1 is your power allocation factor, and A2 is your root A2 is your power allocation factor for user 2. So after, this is your signal that is going to be transmitted from your transmitter, and at the receiver, you have two copies. You have a copy of X1 being received at user 1 and a copy of X being received at user 2. Okay, so at user 1, you have your received signal in the format y1 is equal to h1x plus w1. So this is nothing but Y1 is nothing but your received signal, and H is nothing but your channel training coefficient, and X is your data, and W1 is the noise. Okay, and copy of X received at user 2 is Y2 is equal to H2X plus W2. So again, W2 is your user 2's received data, and H2 is your near user channel, and X is the superposition coded signal, and W2 will be your noise component. So this is your transmitting end equation, and this is your equations at your receiver end, at both your near far user and your near user. Okay, so now that we have seen the SIC concept, we'll see how we are going to decode NOMA at the far user. Okay, so in our system model, we have taken a far user to be user 1 and a near user to be user 2. Okay, so from the previous equation, you can see that your received signal at user 1 is Y1 is equal to H1X plus W1, right? So after taking that equation, we are going to substitute the value of X. Okay, so you know the value of X, that is root P root A into root A1 X1 plus root A2 X2. So you have to just substitute in place of X, and then what we are going to do is we are just going to multiply the components to inside. Okay, so you will arrive at H1 root P root A1X A1 X1 plus, again if you multiply this component inside, you will get H1 root P into root A2 X2 plus W1 is your noise. So here we are going to analyze the performance using your signal to interference noise ratio. Why we are going for signal to interference noise ratio is, as I told, like in far user, you're allocating more power and you're sending your data. But still, at your far user, the data of your near user might be present in small quantity. So we are going to just ignore it as interference. So I'm just taking, instead of taking signal to noise ratio, we are going to consider signal to interference noise ratio, because we have a small role that is going to be played by the near user's data over here. So we know the general definition for signal to noise ratio, that is signal power to noise power. So gamma 1 will be your SINR for far user. So based on that, your you know that this H1 root P root A1 X1 is your is your desired and dominating signal, because we have given high power over here. So this will, and that your user 1 also, you need your H1 data. So this is your desired and dominating signal, whereas this will be your flow power, because we have allocated less power only to the near user. So here, by the time it reaches the far user, this will be your flow power, and it acts as an interference, and this is noise. So I'm substituting this signal power to your noise and interference ratio, you arrive at this equation. So now what we're going to see is the, what is the achievable data rate at the far user.
Excuse me, madam.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me, madam. A1, alpha 1, both are same or different? In the expression, it's there A1, but in the SINR expression, it's given alpha 1.
Okay, there is a typing mistake over here. I think here it should be A2.
Okay, thank you.
No, his question was related to A1 and alpha 1. Yeah, both are same. A1, A2 are power coefficients, power allocation coefficients. That is what it has written as alpha 1, alpha 2.
Okay, so this signal to interference noise ratio, it is going to measure the signal quantity, that is the strength of the wanted signal compared to the unwanted interference and noise. So the achievable data rate can be defined as, like, with the help of the capacity equation, that is log 2 into 1 plus SINR. So log 2 into 1 plus your SINR for your user 1 will be gamma 1. And when you substitute this gamma 1 in place of you have to substitute this equation in place of gamma 1. Again, you have it. Sorry for the typo. Okay. So I think this part would have been clear. Maybe I'll tell it again. So at your receive, at user 1, you receive y1 is equal to h1 x plus w1. So we are going to substitute your superposition coded signal over here, and then we are going to multiply the components inside. So from that, we know that your h1 root t root a1 into x1 will be your desired and dominating signal. And the second part will be your interference, and it will have low power, and the third component is your noise. So with this, we are going to find the signal to interference noise ratio, gamma 1, and then we are going to calculate, we are calculating the achievable data rate using the capacity equation, that is log 2 into 1 plus SINR. So log 2 into 1 plus gamma 1 will result in this equation. So this is the NOMA decoding is user 1 is done. So next we are going to decode the data at near user, that is user 2. Okay, so we know that in user 2 we have sent the for user 2 we have allocated low power when compared to the far user. So in that case your far user's signal will be very dominating in your near user's signal, and this we are going to consider it as interference in this case. So your received signal at user 2 will be y2 is equal to h2x plus w2. So when you substitute again your superposition coded signal in this equation, you get h2 root t into root a1x1 plus root a2x2 plus w2. So again, when you multiply the terms inside, you arrive at these three terms, and you can find your, like, you have a1 root of a1x1. So at user 2, you don't need this user 1's data, right? But this is going to act as an interference, and this is also very dominating because we have given high power for this component. Next is, we have given second component is your desired component, because you have your user 2's data x2 over here. But here, this will be of low power, and this w2 is your noise. So now what we have to, what we can see is your signal to noise interference ratio at user 2. Before applying your SIT algorithm, we are just going to calculate the signal to noise ratio using this equation. So again, gamma 1 2 will be this one. So mod of h2 square into power alpha 1 divided by this interference. For us, this will interference and the noise component over here. So again, you have the achievable. Okay, so to calculate the achievable data rate, again we are going to make use of the capacity equation, that is log 2 into 1 plus SINR. So you have log 2 into 1 plus this gamma 1 2 substituted over here. Okay, so this is before SIC, but I have told like in your near user, we will be using a successive interference cancellation to remove your user one, that is your far user's data. Okay, so how we do that is now we know your y2 is directly, you are going to directly decode it to obtain your x1 or an estimate of x1, and then we are going to multiply your directly decoded x1 with its corresponding power weight, and we are going to subtract it from the received y2 signal. So after which, we are going to again apply BPSK demodulation, and we will get your user 2's data. So after cancellation of user 1's signal using SIC, if you calculate, now we will be calculating the signal to noise ratio because you have removed the interference. Okay, so I told like in user 2, this will be the interference, but using SIC, we need only the second user's data. So we are going to remove this data completely. So you, now your desired signal will only have your user 2 data and the noise component. So with that, when you calculate your signal to noise ratio, you arrive at this equation, that is mod h2 square power into alpha 2 divided by sigma square. So again, to calculate your achievable data rate, we are going to make use of the capacity equation, that is R2 is equal to log 2 into 1 plus SNR. The for SNR in this case is your gamma 2. So again, log 2 into your corresponding SNR you are going to substitute here. Okay. So next, since we have calculated the achievable data rate for both your user 1 and user 2, now we are going to analyze the performance of this NOMA system. So we'll see now how we can do the performance analysis of NOMA in terms of channel capacity and bit rate. For channel capacity, we all know that from Shannon's channel capacity, we have this very famous equation, that is C is equal to bandwidth into log 2 of 1 plus SNR in bits per second. Okay, so now we are going to compare your orthogonal multiple axis versus non-orthogonal multiple axis capacity. So in orthogonal multiple axis, I told like orthogonal resources are allocated to the users, like separate time, separate frequency components are allocated. So at both your near user and far user, you are not going to have any interference. Okay, so since you are using orthogonal resources, your signal to noise ratio will be simply signal power of the near user divided by noise, and for your SNR for your far user will be a signal power of far user divided by noise. Okay, whereas in NOMA, when you calculate the SNR for your near user, okay, yeah, so we have your seen here by noise, because we will be removing the interference term using SIC. So here the interference component is removed. Whereas for the far user, we cannot remove the near users. We are not removing the near users data from there, because it is a very low power and it will also fall under the noise category only. So we are not going to, so here you will have your signal to noise ratio for far user to be power of the far user divided by power of near user plus noise. Okay, so these are the SNRs for the orthogonal multiple axis and non-orthogonal multiple axis far and near users. Now on substituting these SNR in your
excuse me, in the OMA you used to be near notation. In the NOMA also you used to be near notation, but in the OMA we are using the entire power, but in the NOMA we are using the fraction of that power. How can we use the same notation in both the places? These two are different notations, no?
I didn't get the question, sir.
No, in orthogonal multiple axis we are using the whole power P.
Okay.
But here we are using A1 into P. How can we use this? No, in the NOMA SNR near, we use the notation P near, no? That is A1 into P. But in the OMA, this P near is P only. There is no power fraction, only P. But how can we use the same notation for both?
So here you can see that in your non-orthogonal multiple axis, in your near user, when you're calculating your SNR, you're using SIC, we are removing the interference term that is present. We are decoding the user 1's data and we are removing it from the user 2. So we will not have any interference. We solely have only the signal of the user 1 and the noise of the signal of the user 2 signal and the noise component. So you can write it directly as signal to noise ratio, which is going to be similar to that of your orthogonal multiplexes. Whereas in non-orthogonal multiplexes for far user case, you have near user's component also in your signal, right? We are not doing any decoding part to remove it, because we are just giving less power only to your second user. So in that case, you have the noise component, which is going to be present here as an interference. So the only deviation that we get is here.
No, correct. In the NOMA, we have that the power fraction alpha 1 is on the numerator. For that also you use the notation p near, but orthogonal multiplexes we don't have any power fraction. The entire power we are using to transmit the symbol. My question is then can we use the same notation to represent the different powers used in the NOMA and OMA? In OMA the whole power p is used. It seems that alpha 1 or alpha 2 is equal to 1 in the case of OMA. But here in the NOMA case, alpha 1 and alpha 2 is less than 1, some different power fraction values. You use the same notation for the OMA case and NOMA case, that's why I asked. If it is the different notation, fine. It seems the p near in the OMA case and the p near in the NOMA case is equal. But it's not correct. No,
no sir, like your near user, anyway you are going to remove the interference. So it, all, it is anyway going to be your p near by noise only.
No, madam, actually in OMA, this p near is H2, modulus H2 square p divided by sigma square. But in NOMA case, p near is modulus H2 square alpha 2 into p divided by sigma square.
Okay,
okay, you carry
on. Yes sir, so by notation wise what you are telling is correct, so we have not gone deep into that, so maybe I'll we can take this point also into consideration. Okay,
thank you ma'am.
Yes sir. So in your while you are going to substitute your SNR when you are going to substitute your SNR for your orthogonal multiplexes and your non orthogonal multiplexes in your capacity equation, you have your C is equal to bandwidth log 2 into 1 plus SNR, right? So here you can see in orthogonal multiplexes we will be dividing the bandwidth for two user scenario, the bandwidth will be divided into 2 for both the users. So we are using here D by 2 log 2 into 1 plus SNR for the near SNR plus B by 2 log 2 into 1 plus SNR for far users. And for calculating the capacity of non-orthogonal multiple axis, we are using we are representing it as bandwidth into log 2, because we are going to we are not doing any bandwidth division over here, we have bandwidth into log 2 into 1 plus p near by noise, and again plus bandwidth into log 2 into 1 plus your NOMA far SNR for your far user. Okay, so now on substituting the equations using MATLAB, and when we plot the plot them with rate of user 1 in x axis and rate of user 2 in your y axis, you can see that the data rate between u1 and u2 has this line linear. Okay, whereas for a non orthogonal multiple axis you have this curve, it's basically going a little up than the previous curve. So the rate of user 1 and user 2 in the middle region is always better than the case of orthogonal multiplexes. So next we are going to see the capacity comparison of orthogonal multiplexes and non-orthogonal multiplexes. So here we can observe that at low SNR, orthogonal multiplexes perform slightly better than non-orthogonal multiplexes. This is because NOMA suffers from interference due to simultaneous transmission, while orthogonal multiplexes users do not experience any such interference. But at high SNR, we see how NOMA outperforms the orthogonal multiplexes by offering high capacity. So in addition, NOMA accomplishes this while utilizing only minimum resources. For example, in orthogonal multiplexes, if you take TDMA, if you're going to take, it will require 2 time slots to complete the whole transmission. If the duration of 1 time slot is 1 millisecond, then TDMA will require 2 milliseconds to complete this transmission. Whereas in NOMA, we are going to complete the transmission in a single time slot itself, that is in 1 millisecond. So this significantly will reduce the latency. So So this point demonstrates the usefulness of NOMA in future communication technologies. And next, then we calculate the we are going to analyze the performance of NOMA using a bitter rate. So bitter rate is nothing but the rate or ratio of how many bits have been received in error to the total number of bits that have been received. Okay. So bitter rate of NOMA is equal to number of bits in error by total number of bits transmitted. So when you simulate and you see, you can you are defining a bitter rate in as a function of transmit power. You can see that your newer user has better performance than your better bitter rate than your far user, because newer user, the channel condition is very good. You have your channel gain to be good, your channel conditions are good. Whereas in your far user, your channel conditions are not that much good. So there is a difference in the bitter rate. This shows the difference in bitter rate between the far user and the near user. So these are the performance analysis of NOMA in terms of capacity and bitter rate. We can now try and implement the same using MATLAB, and we can see the how coding can be done for NOMA and the output for bitter rate of NOMA. So before we go on to the MATLAB session, if you have any queries, you can ask. Okay, so if you don't have any queries, I think we can go to the MATLAB session.
In the text, I think the message, there is a query.
Compared to orthogonal multiplexes, non-orthogonal multiplexes can give double the capacity if D log is not sufficient.
Generally, what happens in the case of capacity of the NOMA versus OMA is up in the lower SNRs, what is happening? If you observe the lower SNR, see in orthogonal multiplexes, suppose let us consider a TDMA system. Okay, for orthogonal multiplexes system, let us consider a TDMA system. So TDMA, what we do, each slot is specific to the particular user. So the first user uses the first slot, second user uses the second slot, third user uses the third slot. It going to come back in a round robin way. So therefore, there is no interference. Fine. But NOMA is concerned, since on the same spectrum, same carrier frequency, there are two users. Definitely interference will be there. Even though we use successive interference cancellation, interference will be there in any case. Fine. Minimal amount of interference will be there for a near and far users. Now, at the lower SNRs, what is happening is this is very significant, because the lower SNR, the NOMA is not going to give a better capacity than the OMA or the multiplexes, because there is no interference. Interference is almost very no interference in OMA, and there is interference in OMA. Therefore, at lower SNRs, the performance of the orthogonal multiplexes is better. And when you just push more power, the higher powers, what is happening? The NOMA is started to perform well. Therefore, this NOMA is very ideal case for the macrocellular concept, where the base tail radius is more. And one more thing is, the NOMA assumes that the one user is near to the base station, another user is very far away. That means he is in the edge, he is at the cell edge. Okay, that means it is in the border or boundary of the cellular region. So therefore, it assumes that scenario. So when we increasing at the lower SNRs, orthogonal multiplexes is good. When you go for a higher and a higher SNR, non-orthogonal multiplexes is good in terms of the capacity. Okay, fine. This is one side. So there is no straightforward relationship like it's a double or something. As a SNR, it's a function of the SNR. Okay, you can see the capacity or data rate, it is all a function of the SNR. So when the SNR, when we are keep increasing, NOMA is better. When we are keep decreasing, OMA is better. But identically, it is all depends upon. Suppose you take an uncoded system, then the SNR levels are expected to be very high, like we have to go for 20 dB, 30 dB, that much. If it is a coded system, then within 10 dB or 15 dB, you will be able to see the changeover in their capacities or crossover of the capacities between the NOMA and OMA. So this is one answer to the query. And another query is, yeah, there is one more query is also rising in between with respect to the expressions. See, for the OMA, for example, same case which I explained, TDMA systems. So the expression will be the total power into the, it is like the total power divided by the noise variance into the square of the channel gains. So that is the instantaneous SNR. So I'll repeat, the instantaneous SNR is equal to, suppose the total power is PT, which we normally considered in our program, PT into H mod of H square divided by sigma square, where sigma square is a noise variance or noise power. Okay. So this is the expression. And with respect to the NOMA case, we have a different expressions. One is for the far user, there is a different expression. For near user, there is a different expression. But identically, what happened, the speaker is also trying to explain is, for a near user, the P near expression is given P near. And if you look at the expression, the P near expression is P near divided by mod of S square divided by sigma square. That is the expression for the near user after successive interference cancellation. Whereas this is after SIC. The same case with OMA also, after SIC you get the same expression. Expression wise roughly same, but when we use the notations, there we have to use the total power, here you have to use the fractional power. That is the difference. Okay, I think somebody raised up this question.
Thank you for your clarification, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So you can just start the MATLAB session.
Yes, sir.
Please start the MATLAB.
Yes, sir.
And while typing itself, you can explain so that the time can be consumed. I
mean, yes, sir.
The time can be, you know, it can be used effectively.
Okay, sir. Okay, so let us now look into the MATLAB coding for the two-user downlink non-orthogonal multiplexes technique. So to begin with, we are using clear screen command. Okay, to start with, we are now going to define the number of bits that are going to be transmitted. So let n be the number of bits that we are going to transmit. So n is equal to 10 to the power of 6 Okay. So when is your number of bits transmitted? And then we are going to define the distance of users from the base station. So first we will define the distance of the far user with respect to the base station. So the distance of far user in our scenario is x1. So the distance for the far user that we are going to allocate is 1000. And for D2, which is a near user, we are giving a distance of 500. Okay, so next we are going to define the power allocation factor. So the power allocation for user 1, A1, will be equal to 0.75, and for user 2, I am giving a power allocation factor of 0.25. Okay, so as I told already, like the far user is given more power and the less user is given near user is given the less power. So after which we are going to define the path loss component eta. So since the distance plays a role here, we are going to consider the path loss component. We're considering it as 4, so you can change this accordingly based on your application. If you're using for free space, you can keep it as 2. For urban applications, you can keep for 2.7 to 3.5. And we're considering suburban scenario, so we are taking 4 over here. So next we are going to see on how to generate the relay fading coefficient for both the users. So let H1 be your channel fading coefficient for user 1, for your user 1. So in yesterday's afternoon MATLAB session, so this how to generate this relay fading coefficient was being explained. So the channels, we know that the channel fading coefficient is going to follow complex Gaussian distribution with mean 0, and that fading coefficient can be modeled by x plus jy, in that x and y follows Gaussian distribution with mean is equal to 0 and variance 1. So let me define the channel fading coefficient first. Okay, so we have generated the relay fading coefficient for user 1, that is the near user H1. So H1 is the channel fading coefficient for user 1, and we have no, the random standard fading coefficient is going to follow this complex Gaussian distribution with mean 0 and variance 1. So that fading coefficient can be modeled by x plus jy. So in that x and y follows Gaussian distribution with mean 0 and variance 1. So we are modeling x and y using this Randen function, because Randen follows normal distribution with mean 0 and variance 1. So we are going to use the same, going to define the same channel coefficient for user 2 also, that is H2. Okay. So now that we have defined the we have defined the number of bits that has to be transmitted, we have defined the distance between the base station and the near user and the far user, and the power coefficient for your near far user and your near user, and we have defined the path loss component eta, and then we have generated Rayleigh fading coefficients for both user 1 and user 2. Okay, so next we are going to define the transmit power. So this transmit power is defined in dBm. Okay, so we are, the transmit power that we have defined here is in dBm. So now what we are going to do is we are going to convert the transmit power. We have defined the transmit power from 0 to 40 with an increment of 2, and now we are going to convert this transmit power into linear scale, because it is represented in dBm. So to convert it to linear scale, okay, so capital CP is the transmit power in dBm, and we are, in the next line we are converting the conversion of dBm into linear scale by 10 multiplying like 10 to the power of minus 3 into 10 to the power of CP divided by 10. Okay, so next we are going to define the system bandwidth. So bandwidth is 1 megahertz. We are taking 1 megahertz bandwidth. So six. And next we will define the noise power. Okay, so noise power is defined represented as N naught. So noise power is represent is the KTP. Okay, our system bandwidth is 1 megahertz. So let's calculate the thermal noise power as N naught is equal to KTB. So where K is your Boltzmann constant, which is 1.38 into 10 power of minus 23 joules per Kelvin, and your temperature T is equal to 300 Kelvin. Okay, so for noise power we have KTB, so for that we are multiplying both the Boltzmann constant and T. When we multiply both the values, we will get minus 174 plus 1.74. Okay. So now that we have defined the noise power which we have defined here is in dBm. Again, we are going to convert it into a linear scale. So N naught is equal to Okay, so the noise power is also converted to linear scale. So next we are going to generate a noise sample for both the users. So noise sample for user 1 is W1. So yes, in yesterday's afternoon session, a detailed explanation was given on how to define this noise sample. So I'm directly writing the equation for the noise sample. We're also defining the noise power for user 2, is W2. Okay. So next, what we are going to do is we are going to generate a random binary data for two users. So in our PPT, we saw that we had user 1's data to be 1010 and your user 2's data to be 1101. So similarly, we are going to generate a random binary data for both the users like this. So your data 1 will be your user 1's data. So that is randio. Zero, random numbers, zeros and ones. The length of 1, n. Okay, so we are generating random. We are doing random generation of integers. So from zeros and ones, from 1 to n, one row and n columns. Okay. So next, again, we are going to okay, so now we have generated random binary data for the user 2 also. Okay, so next we are going to do BPSK modulation of data. So I have previously told, like, in BPSK modulation, we are mapping the zeros and ones to plus 1 and minus 1. So x1 is equal to 2 into data of 1 minus 1. So here we have data 1 is randomly generated integers of zeros and 1. So if your input is 0, 2 into 0 will be 0, and minus 1 will give you minus 1. Again, for if your input is 1, it will be 2 into 1, 2, minus 1 will be 1. So you will get your BPSK modulated data from here. So similarly, I am doing BPSK modulation for user 2's data also. Okay, so now we will get into the concept of doing the superposition coding and SIC, successive interference cancellation. So we are defining the length of the loop. The transmitter. So we have a transmit power from defined from 0 to 40 at an increment of 2. So let E be your length of the transmit power, and using a for loop. Okay, so now we are going to write the expression for superposition coding. So we know the equation for superposition coding is x is equal to square root of p into square root of a1 x1 plus root of a2 x2, right? So we'll define that now. So x is equal to square root of your power square root of a1 into x1 plus square root of into x2. So I hope you are clear with this equation. So in our PPT we had so superposition coded NOMA signal is x is equal to root p into root a1 x1 plus root a2 x2. So we have defined our superposition coded signal. So next we have our received signals, right? So your received signals at user 1 and user 2 are y1 and y2. So we are write an equation to calculate our y1. So y1 is nothing but your h1 channel 1 into your data superposition coded signal plus your noise. Okay. So similarly for your received signal 2, we are going to write the same equation. So y2 is equal to h2 into okay, so nothing but we have defined this equation first. So next we are defining both the received signals. So next we are going to assume that the full channel state information is known at the receiver. We are going to equalize y1 and y2 by dividing by h1 and h2 respectively. Okay, so we're equalizing y1 similarly we are equalizing your y2. Okay, so now we'll see what happens at user 1. So at user 1 we are going to do direct decoding of x1 from y1, right? So that is our first step in the successive interference calculation. So for that what I'm going to do is I'm going to define h1 hat to be x1 is equal to zeros of one comma n. So here your x1 hat will be a matrix of 1 cross n, which will be 1 cross n zero. So now what we are going to do is next we are going to do the Okay, so here at user 1, we are going to from the equalized version of Y1, we are performing direct VPSK demodulation to get your X1 hat. So X1 hat will have zeros, so one row and n columns of zeros. And now what will happen is, you will compare your, you have, if your equalizer 1 value is greater than 0, we will be assigning 1. If it is less than 0, it will be 0 again, okay? So now you would have your decoded X1 data is decoded and it is stored in your X1 hat, right? So now in order to find your, we are going to compare your decoded X1 hat with user 1's original data to calculate the bitter rate, okay? So to calculate bitter rate, we are going to make use of the inbuilt bitter function in MATLAB. So here it will compare both the final X1 hat and our user 1's initial data, and it will, if both are same, then the error is not considered. If both are different, then the error count is being increased, okay? So we can calculate bitter rate for the user 1 using the bitter function. Divided by number of bits transmitted. Okay, so we have performed the first step in SIC, wherein the direct, we have done the direct decoding of Y1 signal at X1 from Y1. Okay, so next at user 2, we'll see what happens. So here I am defining X1 hat to be 1 of 1 command, because X12 hat is nothing but the decoding of user, decoding the data of user 1 in your second, from your second user, okay? So X12 hat is equal to 1, so you have an array of 1. So now again what we are going to do is, we are going to directly decode the equalized version of X2 to estimate X12 hat, okay? So okay, so here if your equalizer 2 value is less than 0, then we are going to consider the bit as minus 1. Otherwise, it will be 1 only, because we have defined like 1 only. So next. Okay, so this is your successive interference cancellation equation. So first we have done the direct decoding of the signal that was given high power. So we have decoded, we have done the direct decoding of X to get your X1 hat. Next, in your user 2, we have used the decoded symbol, and then we are going to minus this detected root A1 X1 from your superposition coded signal. So that is what we have done here. So we are subtracting the remodulated x1 component from the equalized version of x2 to get your decoded x2 signal. Okay, so next from this we are going to do the BPSK demodulation. So if your y2 dash is greater than 0, it is going to be 1. So now that we have decoded the user 2's data also, we are going to calculate the bit error rate again using the bit error function. Okay, we are ending the loop here and now we are going to plot our bit error rate as a function of transmit power. So labeling the x-axis to the transmit power. We are also labeling the y-axis. Okay, so let me give a quick recap on what has been done. So first we have defined the number of bits over here. So one minute. Okay, so we have n, which is 10^6, which is number of bits that have been transmitted, and then we are defining the distance between the base station and the user one, that is a far user, and then the distance from the base station to the near user, that is D2, as 500. For D1, we have kept it as 1000, and then we are defining the power allocation factors A1 and A2 to be 0.75 and 0.25, and we are giving higher power for the far user, and for the near user we are giving less power. So A1, we should allocate A1 and A2 in such way that A1 plus A2 will be equal to 1. And then path loss component is being defined, eta is being defined here. And next we have the generation of relay fading coefficient, which is for user 1's channel and user 2's channel, that is H1 and H2. We have this square root of D1 power minus eta is being multiplied along with this equation, and then we have defining our transmit power PT from 0 to 40 at an increment of 2, and since it is in dBm, we are converting it to linear scale, and then again the bandwidth of the system is again 10^6, and then we have defined the noise power. So noise power is of the form KTB, where K is your Boltzmann constant and T will be your 300 Kelvin. So when you multiply both and take 10 log, you will get -174 plus the B component is your bandwidth part. And then since again this is also in dBm, we are converting the noise power to linear scale. And then we are generating noise samples for both the users, for user 1 and user 2. And then we are generating random binary data for both the users using randi command. And then we are doing BPSK modulation for both user 1's data and user 2's data. So here if your data will be zeros and 1, so if your data is going to be 0, so 2 into 0 minus 1 will be minus 1, and 2 into 1 minus 1 will be 1. And next we are going to take the length of P to be the length of your transmit power, and we're going to create a loop. So we have going to we have defined the superposition coding equation over here, that is x is equal to root p into square root of a1 x1 plus square root of a2 x2, and then we are defining the received signals over here, that is y1 is equal to h1 into x plus y2, and your y2 is equal to h2 into x plus w2. So now assuming that full channel state information is known at the receiver, we are going to equalize Y1 and Y2 by dividing H1 and them by H1 and H2 respectively. So after that, we are going to apply the SIC concept here in your user 1. So we know that in user 1, we are just going to do direct decoding. We did BPSK modulation at the transmitter side. So again, we are doing BPSK demodulation, where we are defining a variable x1 hat with zeros from 1 to n, and if your equalizer value is greater than 0, it will be replaced, that your zeros will be replaced as 1, otherwise it will remain as 0. So you will have a stream of zeros and 1s in your x1 hat now. Okay, so now in order to calculate the bit array, we are going making use of the bit error function in MATLAB, so which will compare your final detected bits with your input data, and whenever there is a difference, the error count is taken. Otherwise, when there is no difference, error is not counted. And at user 2, we are doing first we are going to decode the user 1's information from the user 2's data. So for that, we are defining an array of 1. So in that, when you're comparing your equalizer to data, there when it is less than 0, it will be replaced as -1. If it is greater than 0, it will be 1. So now you will have your x1, 2 had data in 1s and minus 1s, which we can use for remodulating the data. And next you have y2 dash. So it is nothing but your doing this step where x is equal to x minus root 1 root of a1 in, into x1. Okay, so after that we are again going to do this BPSK modulation over demodulation over here, where we are going to compare y2 dash. If it is going to be greater than 0, it will be 1. If it is less than 0, it will be 0. So again, you will have zeros and ones over in your x2 hat. And now again, to calculate the bitter rate performance of the near user, we are making use of the bitter function. So again, we compare the data to and your x2 hat data to find if there is any error. Okay, so after which we are plotting the bitter rate for user 1 and user 2 in term in, as a function of transmit power. Okay. Okay, so now we have got the bitter rate performance of both your near user and far user. So both are represented as a function of transmit power. We can see that your near user's performance is better when compared to your far user, because your near user has good channel condition. So you can see it is providing good bitter rate performance. So this is a simple coding on how a two-user downlink NOMA scenario can be constructed. So that's it for this session. So